Well, good morning, brothers and sisters. It's good to see everybody here this morning. We are privileged that we get to gather in the name of Jesus with other followers of his in the midst of the mess and the difficulty and the glories that our lives each contain in order to hear from him. And be encouraged and be challenged and be filled with his spirit. That's what we're doing this morning. That's why we're here. And that because that's why we're here, we're going to start the way we always start, with a reading from the Psalms, letting his voice give us the pitch for our worship, letting him have the first word. This is coming out of Psalm 84 for the choir director. Says the psalmist, a psalm of the descendants of Korah, to be accompanied by a stringed instrument. And if I had my friend Drew here, I'd have him pluck something on the guitar or play something on the violin for us. But you'll have to imagine this psalm set to stringed instruments. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of heaven's armies. I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter the courts of the Lord. With my whole being, body and soul, I will shout joyfully to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow builds her nest and raises her young at a place near your altar, O Lord of heaven's armies, my King and my God. What joy for those who can live in your house, always singing your praises. What joy for those whose strength comes from the Lord, who've set their minds on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. When they walk through the valley of weeping, it will become a place of refreshing springs. The autumn rains will clothe it with blessings. They will continue to grow stronger, and each of them will appear before God in Jerusalem. O Lord God of heaven's armies, hear my prayer. Listen, O God of Jacob. O God, look with favor upon the King, our shield. Show favor to the one you have anointed. A single day in your courts is better than 1,000 anywhere else. I'd rather be a gatekeeper in the house of my God than live the good life in the homes of the wicked. For the Lord God is our sun and our shield. He gives us grace and glory. The Lord will withhold no good thing from those who do what is right. O Lord of heaven's army, what joy for those who trust in you. Amen. Would you stand with me? And we're going to say our call to worship before we go on to worship God, the doxology and the singing. You guys will say the bits of this that are bolded on the screen. Morning. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of heaven's armies. With my whole being, body, and soul,
I will shout joyfully to the living God.
For the Lord God is our sun and our shield.
He gives us grace and glory.
The Lord will withhold no good thing from those who do what is right.
O Lord of heaven's armies, what joy for those who trust in you.
Amen. Let's sing the doxology together as our sister Kay comes to lead us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. Let's continue in worship. You just have to hit the arrow button.
Dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, my soul longs and even faints for you. For him my heart is satisfied within your presence. I sing beneath the shadow of your wing. How lovely.
Thousands elsewhere. There is
Lord God, we spend a lot of our days worried about a lot of different things. We spend a lot of our days in houses that aren't yours, contemplating things you'd rather us abandon. We ask you to forgive us for when we wander off. We ask for you to draw us back. Come find us, Good Shepherd, when we wander. And bring us back again into your sheepfold. Restore us, capture us and captivate us, protect us and lead us right back into your house, where we can worship you and praise you and fellowship with your followers, where we can celebrate and where we can learn and where we can grow bolder and more beautiful in your gospel every day. Thank you for bringing us into your house this morning. Thank you for letting us be here shoulder to shoulder, voice with voice, in this place this morning for this purpose. Thank you that we are here, that we are alive, that we are loved by you, that we are forgiven by you, that we are welcomed by you into this place, whoever we are, whatever state our heart or mind or soul is in this morning, you have brought us here. Help us, Lord God, to lay down before you, even in this moment of prayer, those other things that we've been chasing or thinking of. That even when we leave this physical place, we would stay in the place your glory dwells. That we would abide with you. When we leave here, we go to work or school, we go home, we go back, Lord, from this place into whatever you have for us this afternoon and tomorrow. We're asking this in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you may be seated. All right, a few announcements and a few that I need to try to remember that aren't on here. I don't believe we have lunch today. This is a good thing and a bad thing. We have seen such an uptick in the need at our Friday ministry that we do with Food for the Journey that we're like giving out all the food on Fridays. There's none left over for lunches on Sundays. So this was a slow Friday and we still gave over 300 meals out. So that is a beautiful thing we're doing for our neighbors, but pray for Food for the Journey and for our church that we can figure out how to meet that need. Cause it's a sad thing that there's that amount of need. We had a homeless quite a few homeless people come on Fridays. We had this one homeless couple in particular that sat inside with us the whole time. When they left, they went and they just kind of set up camp on the far side of our yard. I got to sit and talk with them a little while, both that day and then later this weekend. I'm not sure where they are this morning. They were going to try to get into a place. They thought they had a cousin maybe that would take them in. These are our neighbors. We're serving them on Fridays. They're beloved by Jesus. And so pray for our neighborhood and pray for our ability as a little fellowship of Jesus followers to meet and love those people where they're at. Would you go back one slide? I'm just trying to remember if I made every announcement I needed to. Just hit the left key. Yeah. Our website is a great way to connect with us. You can always go there. And we have call lists. And so if you want to be alerted when we're doing special things, just talk to me or Pastor Susan when she's around. You'll hear about her during prayer time. She's not here this morning. But you can talk to us and we'll get you on those. And then we do have breakfast every Sunday morning at 9. And this morning there was cinnamon bun baked oatmeal. It was very tasty. It was dessert for breakfast and I enjoyed it. And so if you can come in fellowship in the morning, do that. If you want to be part of making that happen, if you want to bake something or cook something or prepare it at home and bring it, we'd welcome that kind of volunteering. And if you need us to cover the cost, that's great. You'd be volunteering your time and effort. The church can cover the cost. Of course, you can donate the cost too. It's up to you, but you don't need to worry about the cost if you can cook. We also have this Wednesday night ministry every Wednesday night at 6:30. This week looks like we're doing a family fun night. We kind of alternate between playing together and studying the Word of God together. And so this week is a week to play. And we just fellowship, we hang out, we have fun, because church is family, spiritual family. And one thing that families do together is they play together. They just spend time, quality time together. And so that's what that Wednesday will be for, this Wednesday at 6:30. Friday, as I was mentioning, if you don't know, probably everybody here knows, but if you don't know, every Friday, 12:30, there's a lunch. We usually open up the clothing that we distribute by 11 a.m. and we're distributing clothing and we're distributing, like grocery pantry type items. Dave Jones and his sister Robin helps with this, and some others do as well, but they're kind of the ringleaders. They bring pantry items and just bits and bobs and odds and ends. We got a donation of fabric squares. We got a donation of, and we just get people things that they might want or need. So that's every Friday. And it's actually a pretty fun crew to hang out with if you want to come volunteer. There's a team of people that volunteer downstairs. There's a team of people that volunteer upstairs, outside, and you can do either. And you can do that for 15 minutes if you got 15 minutes, or you can come. And very often it's kind of, you know, there's 3 or 4 hours worth of work to do each Friday if you want to stay that long. Okay. Now, do you see the man behind the screens over here? You would know Adam, most of you. This is Adam. Adam is spearheading a men's camping trip. I'm going. And it's coming up on Friday, this coming Friday. And the spot is really sweet. We'll either have the spot that you guys had last time or one very near it on the Miami River. Just absolutely lovely looking. We're going to fellowship. We're going to cook around the fire. We're going to pray together and just connect as men in the Lord. And so here's the other cool thing. This does not cost you anything. If you're a guy and you want to come, even if you don't have a tent or you don't have a sleeping bag, that's okay. We can, almost certainly we have enough to cover you. So just talk to us. And in fact, we kind of need a headcount today to secure everything we need to secure and make sure we have everything we need. So if you're a guy and you want to come on this, or you think you want to come, can I see your hand? That we'd be leaving the church Friday at 5 p.m. Okay, so, okay, very cool. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so 7, and then we can factor in others that we know might be, yeah. Okay, thanks guys for doing that. You're now all on the list publicly. I do kind of hate doing that sort of thing, making people put people on the spot, but that just helps us. Yeah, trying to remember after church. I don't remember stuff after church. Okay, now the next thing I think is at least one more that's on here. Yes, okay. So the crop walk. Dave, are you raising your hand for the men's camping trip? No, okay, you're shrinking away instead. All right, that's all right. All right, so the crop hunger walk. So every year, this organization, it's a national organization, helps raise funds to end hunger here and abroad. And one of their main fundraisers is called the Crop Walk. And basically, you can support this in a couple ways. You can donate money. And so if you have money and you can donate money, that's great. And you can do that at their website and you don't have to walk at all. But the kind of the point of this is that you would sign up and register to walk. And they have like two different courses, and you can walk a full course that day, and they have it laid out for you. One goes kind of through like a woodsy cemetery, and one actually goes through like around the city up there near the Shiloh Church where this is being hosted. And what you can do is, you're walking in support, you're showing up on the day up, do that, but you can also get like sponsors. You know, people can say, yeah, I'll sponsor you for the walk, and they'll pledge to donate a certain amount towards the crop walk, towards feeding hungry people. So this is happening. The registration starts on October, and this is on October 9th, so we have plenty of time to prepare. It's 1 p.m. on Sunday, October 9th, and then the walk starts at 1:30. You should bring your own water bottle. They'll be able to help you fill that up. If anybody here, like if this is the kind of thing where you feel like you could be kind of passionate about this, maybe you'd get into it, and you would want to help the church organize our own team. You can like register as a team. If that's something you might be interested in, talk to me. If there's nobody who can take that on, it's okay. We can register as individuals and meet up, and I'll help coordinate that. But if you just were like, ooh, that sounds cool, or you just want to know more, you don't have to commit to it, but if you just want to know more, like maybe I'd be a team leader, talk to me and I can give you more information. I got a whole info sheet for you. I'm encouraging everybody, try that out on that Sunday. Okay, that's good. Leave it on that slide, Adam. I have two other announcements. If I can read my, oh yes, I can read my own writing. I really couldn't read that top one first. We on Fridays, one thing we have grown short on recently are plastic grocery bags. We use them outdoors, especially, we use them indoor and out, but we use them outdoors, especially people take stuff away in them. And we had like a million and we kind of stopped taking donations because we had a million and then we ran through them all and we're back to needing. So if you like have, you know, like some wicker basket in the back of your house where you put all those Kroger bags and they're just sitting there, we want them. That's gold to us right now. So bring them to the church and we'll use them and homeless folks and neighborhood people will come and fill up bags and take them away and it'll bless somebody. All right, last announcement. There are three little ones in the church this morning. Ayla, you can meet her in the back later, her dad, Jeff. We got Silas over here with Kat and Greg. My daughter back there just turned three and her birthday party is this afternoon at 4 p.m. and everybody's invited. You can all come. We got family and friends and church family all invited. And great question, where? It may be at the park and it may be here if it's raining. So talk to me. And if we don't already have your number, we'll get your number and we'll send out like a mass text. We'll also update the Facebook page or whatever else we got. And my wife will sort of let you know. It's supposed to be at a park, one of the metro parks with a shelter and everything. We'll see. Hills and Dales. Thank you. I'm terrible with details, even with my family. But Dinah knows. Dinah knows where my daughter's party is. You're all invited at 4 p.m. and we'll make sure you know where it is. Okay. Now I do think that's everything. And we have our offering. And this offering, everything we do on Sunday is worship. Even those announcements, that's part of worship. Because we're a church family. We're a body of Christ. We're part of the body of Christ. And so when we gather together, what we're doing is trying to live life together to the glory of God. And so we organize ministries of help. We feed people. We organize ministries of fellowship and play so that our connection, our fellowship, our koinonia can be built up. We update each other on what's going on in our body. That's all part of worship. And of course, it's worship when we sing to God. It's such an intimate act. How often do you sing other than at church? I don't do it much at all outside of church. And you can tell that if you ever are near me in church when I sing. But we sing to God in church. That's worship. Powerful worship. It's worship when we give to God. You and I are meant to give all we have to God. Every penny in my bank account, every object in my possession, my body itself have been given to me by God to be used his way. Because I'm just a steward. And when we give in church, we're not having a fundraiser for the organization. When we give in church, we're taking a moment in this service to worship God by giving a portion of what we have. All of it's his, but we give over a portion to the church, saying by that act, God, all that I have is yours. And as a token of my love and as a sign of that fact, here is a portion of it for the body of Christ, for the brothers and sisters in the church, that ministry that the church does together, that those things we do together can happen. And can flourish. When we release things into the hands of God, he tends to break them apart and do stuff with them we wouldn't have thought, and he multiplies them and makes them go farther than we could ever have done on our own. And so this is worship, brothers and sisters. Give as you have been given to. You can only give what you have. Don't feel less than if you do not have money to give. There should be cards in front of you in the pews, and on those cards, you can write a pledge from your heart. You can write a pledge of something you're going to do and say, Lord, I don't even have the two copper coins that the widow had in the story from the Gospels, but Lord, I've got time, and I'm going to go and take some of that time, and I'm going to visit a sick sister this week. or visit something, or call somebody I know who's feeling a little lonely. In prayer time last week, we had multiple people in our body that we said, these people are kind of stuck in, they're lonely, they're sick, they need contact. That would be an excellent offering. To write a pledge on a card and say, Lord, I'm gonna call our sister Margie, or I'm gonna visit my brother Pat in the hospital, or whatever it is. That's my offering, Lord. It's a great offering. Whatever you've been given, give of it today. Not because you have to, because you don't. Not at all. Feel no obligation. Give because you've been given to. Give because God loves you. Give because you want to say, I love you back, Abba Father. Let's pray as Mike and maybe Guy will join him in the offering. Abba Father, we thank you for all you have given to us. We owe to you whatever is good in our lives. Each good relationship, each good material blessing, each thing, Lord God, is a way that you have said, I love you. Some of us have much materially, and some of us have very little. But we give to you out of what you've given to us, knowing that even if we have little materially, we have much spiritually. That you have made us rich in the Spirit. And so, Lord God, receive our gifts given this morning, knowing that we love you and that we want help from you to love better, more deeply, more clear-sightedly, more perseveringly. We give to you, God, who gave everything to us. Amen. As the ushers come, you may sit or stand, adopt whatever posture you want to. As we have a brother on video here who's going to share the song Victory in Jesus. And it's a good version. It's a cappella. And you can join in if you want to. The lyrics will be on the screen. I just worship in whatever way feels most comfortable.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about him. see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory, Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory, Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me, and I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Said he loved me, I knew him, and all of my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Oh, thank you, Lord.
Can we get that guy here? Good morning, church. That is a beautiful version of that song about King Jesus who brings victory to us. We're going to read together an account of another king that had a victory before he was the king. And each of us face giants in our lives. And this is a story about how you face those giants, where your heart's at when you face those giants, and what kind of tools you need. And may we all do it with the same kind of courage that King David had. Don't worry about this Philistine Goliath, David told Saul. I'll go fight him. Don't be ridiculous, Saul replied. There's no way you can fight this Philistine and possibly win. You're only a boy and he's a man of war since his youth. But David persisted. I've been taking care of my father's sheep and goats, he said. When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club and rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and I club it to death. I have done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine. 2. For he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the claws of the lion and the bear will rescue me from this Philistine. Saul finally consented. All right, go ahead, he said. Then may the Lord be with you. Then Saul gave David his own armor, a bronze helmet and a coat of mail. David put it on, strapped the sword over it, and took a step or two to see what it was like, for he had never worn such things before. I can't go in these, he protested to Saul. I'm not used to them. So David took them off again. He picked up 5 smooth stones from a stream and put them into his shepherd's bag.
Then, armed only with his shepherd's staff and sling, he started across the valley to fight the Philistine. Goliath walked out toward David with his shield bearer ahead of him, sneering in contempt at this ruddy-faced boy. "Am I a dog?" he roared at David, "that you come at me with a stick?" And he cursed David by the names of his gods. "Come over here and I'll give your flesh to the birds and wild animals," Goliath yelled. David replied to the Philistine, "You come at me with sword, spear, and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Today the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut off your head. And then I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. And everyone assembled here will know that the Lord rescues his people, but not with sword and spear. This is the Lord's battle, and he will give you to us." As Goliath moved closer to attack, David quickly ran out to meet him, reaching into his shepherd's bag. Taking out a stone, he hurled it with his sling and hit the Philistine in the forehead. The stone sank in, and Goliath stumbled and fell face down on the ground. So David triumphed over the Philistine with only a sling and a stone, for he had no sword. He had something better.
Brothers and sisters, we've got a sermon that is going to start a little mini series that will lead us to the end of the book of Ephesians, which we've been in for quite some time. So probably after this, maybe two sermons left in that series before we move on. We are in Ephesians chapter 6, if you want to turn there. We're going to be reading verses 10 through 15, a pretty famous passage this. And remember how I said keep the whole David and Goliath imagery with the armor of Saul, keep that in mind. Okay, well, hopefully it's still in there because it's going to apply as we look at this passage. So I'm going to read the whole thing and then I'm going to comment upon it with you bit by bit. So here's Paul moving towards the end of his letter. Says this, a final word. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor, so that you will be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities in the unseen world, against mighty powers in the dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor, so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news, so that you will be fully prepared. And we're going to pause there because I'm not going to try to subject you to a sermon where I try to go through all the armor. We'll pick up the rest of the armor later. We're just going to cover a bit of this passage this morning. And I want to start with how he starts. He says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor. And I find it significant that he says, don't put on all the armor that God provided you or put on all your armor. He says, put on God's armor. Now, who can wear God's armor? Who fits in to the king's armor? Only the king can wear the king's armor. The king's armor only fits on the king, right? You remember David in the passage that Guy read for us, and he tries on Saul's armor, and David's kind of scrawny, and Saul's kind of burly, you know, and this armor, it doesn't fit on me. It's not right for me, right? And he goes out and he faces Goliath with only a sling, and that's beautiful and profound, right? There's a lesson in that story about not trying to wear somebody else's armor. But in this passage, we're told to put on God's armor. My goodness, If David didn't fit in Saul's armor, how am I going to fit in God's armor, right? But that's why I really think this is something that Paul is driving at. That's why Paul doesn't say that first. What does he say first? He says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Earlier in this very letter, in Ephesians chapter 4, Paul addressed the believers and he said that you need to allow the Spirit to work in your midst through your leaders until you are all knit together in the unity of faith and built up to the full measure of the stature of Christ, for you are his body. The king's armor only fits on the king's body. And who are we? We are the body of Christ. We can wear the armor of Christ because we are the body of Christ. His armor fits on us because who we are by grace is him. Paul said in Galatians 2:20, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And so only as I become strong in the Lord, only as I am with the brothers and sisters built up to the full measure and the stature of Christ, can I wear the armor of Christ. And that point, this point about being the body of Christ and measuring up to his full stature, makes a lot of sense of something that is invisible to us in the English, but is there in the original Greek of this passage. And I keep having to, in this particular sermon series, talk about Greek, which I normally try to avoid. But Paul is a writer that can be kind of dense. And there are things in this letter that I think it's worth telling you about that enrich our understanding from the original language. And one of them is this address, both the be strong, the command in the Greek, and the put on command, are rendered in the second person plural in Greek. That means that he's saying, you guys be strong together. You guys put on together the armor of God. In Ephesians 4, you all need to be built up together into the full measure and stature of Christ. That's also a second person plural. I can't be all that Christ is by myself. Jesus is far more than me. He's far more than you. I will reflect a part of who Christ is in my individual life. You will reflect a part of who Christ is in your individual life. Only as we are, as Ephesians 4 said, knit together in unity, do we together achieve the full measure of the stature of Christ. And it's only together, achieving the full measure of his stature, that we can don his armor. We'll talk about the pieces of the armor, right? The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness. Some people have a special gift for truth telling in the church. We call them prophets. Some people have a special gift for acts of hospitality and service, and they demonstrate the righteousness of God thereby. Some of us are more like a belt, some of us more like a breastplate, just as some of us are more like an ear or an eye. We all have a role to play in the body, but not all the same role, but it's all the same body. I think this passage works at an individual level. You can read it as I need to wear each of these myself, and that's true. But it is also meant, and we don't usually think of it this way, it is also meant as a description of who we as the body of Christ are to be and what armor we together as the body of Christ are meant to wear. That the church will only be protected from the fiery darts of the enemy if we hold up the shield of faith. That we will only be girt together and our armor will only fit together if we are belting up with the belt of truth. So you could read this in the individual level, that's fine, but know that it is also at least intended to be something that is true of us as a church together. Only if we're in him and empowered by him, only if we're achieving the full measure of his stature can we wear his armor. Otherwise, we're going to look like David in Saul's armor, and that won't do us any good. Now, we're called to this. We're called to put on this armor, to be enabled to wear it for a reason. So you will be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. Now, this is an important point, but it's a sobering one. Satan has strategies for destroying us. Guys, there's evil in this world. I don't think I have to tell you that. You can see it on the news every night to the extent that it will depress you. You can see it in the history of our world. I remember very recently for something at school. I have a school job at the University of Dayton. I was doing some research. And in the Belgian Congo, the imperial authorities from Belgium that had control of that area were especially brutal to the African natives. And I found this photo of a strong young man, African man, very dark-skinned man. And he was sitting on the stoop of what looked like a plantation house. And he was looking down in front of him. And down in front of him were two small severed hands. And the caption of the photo read that this man had been put on a plantation and he had not met his quota for the day. And so the authorities had severed the hands of his four-year-old little girl as a punishment. And he stood looking down with despair on his face. As I read, I discovered that millions of Africans were killed in their homes and worked to death by authorities there. I never even heard of these events before reading those things. Our world is awash in evil, so much of which is invisible to us because one of the strategies of the devil is to get us to look away from evil, to get us to forget it, to get us to minimize it, to get us to focus only on ourselves. The devil is our enemy. He is out to steal, kill, and destroy, say the scriptures. Our families and our homes. He's out to destroy your relationship with your Heavenly Father, to get you any way he can get you away from God, to distract you, to entice you, to pummel you. He doesn't care which. If he can get us away from God with pleasures, he'll do it. If he can get us away from God by pummeling us, he'll do it. He has multiple strategies. We have an enemy. There is evil in this world, and he is strategizing how to hurt us. And that's our enemy. Remember, Paul says here, you are not fighting against flesh and blood. As heinous as what those Belgians did, they were not really the enemy. They were tools of the enemy, no doubt. They were tools of the enemy. And so were the Romans that crucified Jesus. And yet Jesus forgave even the men who killed him. Here's the mystery of grace, that Jesus wishes to save those oppressed and those oppressing. He wishes to save the good, relatively speaking, and the evil. Because all of us alike are sinners. All of us alike are people whom are being plotted against by Satan. And so we do not ever get called to a physical fight, but to a spiritual one. So how do we respond to this fact that the devil has strategies to bring us down, to destroy our world? We are not to respond with fear. I've kind of laid this on a little thick right here and right now, because I do think that one of the strategies of the enemy is to get us to forget. But the opposite of forgetting that we have an enemy, a spiritual enemy, and that he's plotting to destroy us, the opposite of that is not to panic. If you panic in a battle, bad things happen. That's true in earthly battles, and that's true of the spiritual battle that we're called to. You're not called to panic or be afraid. You are called to be prepared. You are called to put on together with your brothers and sisters the armor of God, because here's the good news. Our enemy is a serious threat to us, right? In the same way that hunter-gatherers were a serious threat to large prey long ago, right? You know, if you had a bow and an arrow and a spear and you were hunting down, you know, some game, a gazelle, well, that gazelle is going to be pretty terrified of the guy with the bow. But imagine you could take, you know, a tank back to the time of bows and arrows. Well, whoever was in that tank would have nothing to fear from whoever had that bow and arrow, would they? And whoever wears the armor of God has nothing to fear from Satan. Whoever puts on, whoever dons the armor of Christ the King has no reason to be afraid of the enemy. Now, let's talk about what that armor is. We're going to talk about the first two items. The first is the belt of truth. It's the very first one that's mentioned. And has anybody here ever tried to read the King James Version of the Bible? It's got, yeah, old school language, right? And if you've ever read the King James or heard the King James, you would probably have heard this phrase. This is how the King James puts it. And it's actually a very literal translation of what's here. It says, gird up your loins with the truth. Gird up your loins, if you've heard that phrase, right? Because what we're really talking about is not, I'm wearing a belt right now. What we're really talking about is kind of what you put on first around your most private and tender area. Gird your loins up with what? With truth. That's how you start getting dressed, right? You gird your loins. Well, what are you girding with? You gird them with truth. Now, this is important, right? For a number of reasons. One is it is that most sensitive area and the most private. And what do you put around the most sensitive, most private, innermost part of yourself? What's the first thing that you put over yourself? Paul says it needs to be the truth. You need to speak the truth to yourself and to others. When we lie to ourselves, when we lie to God, when we lie to others, it's like you're putting on nasty, dirty underwear. Other people are going to smell it. You're going to walk around smelling it all day. You don't. This is too gross of an image for a sermon, probably, right? But that is kind of a picture, right? That you want to gird yourself with the truth. If you don't start with that, if you're not honest with yourself, with God, and with others, this other stuff is not gonna fit you. It's not gonna work for you. If you build your life on a lie, on any lie. Sometimes we think we can get away with little lies. Lies snowball so fast. Everybody's had this experience. I'm convinced of it. Because I can even think when you're little, I think, you know, you start realizing, oh, I cannot tell the truth, right? You eventually figure out as a kid how to lie. Nobody even has to teach you. You can just kind of figure this out. Like, I don't have to tell my mom that I did eat that cookie. I can try to get away with that. I can say, I didn't eat that cookie. And so we've all had the experience of lies snowballing on us, of getting bigger and bigger and bigger. You want to gird yourself with fresh, clean truth. If you do, the rest of the armor is going to fit just right. It won't chafe. It won't scrape you or harm you. It'll nestle softly against your flesh and guard you from the outside, what that fresh garment of truth protects on the inside. And I do think it's the lying to ourselves that may be the hardest one to really let go of. You can lie to yourself actively, telling yourself false stories. You can also lie to yourself by omission, which is to say, you can just avoid certain truths in a way that renders your entire internal picture false. You know, you sometimes wonder, you can see something else about someone or about somebody else's relationship that just is just so obviously unhealthy. And you ask the person about it and they are just completely ignorant of it. And you wonder how in the world they don't see that. Have you ever had a friend where you're maybe trying to help them and they don't see? You're not seeing this? Well, it's not that they are blind, at least not naturally so. It's that bit by bit, they lied themselves into an ignorance on the inside. And you know what you're ignorant of, what you're not addressing, what you're lying about to yourself? Is never going to get addressed or fixed or healed. It can be addressed. It can be fixed. It can be healed. It can be restored. It can be vivified and resurrected if you'll speak the truth about it. If you'll gird up your loins with truth. But you have to do that. What truth? Whose truth? In our world today, that's an important question, isn't it? Pilate, when Jesus said, I came to testify to the truth, what did Pilate say? Anybody remember this? He says, what is truth? What is truth? I don't know about truth. I know about power. I know might makes right and might makes true. I'll say what's true, Jesus, and that's what counts. Practically everybody in our world right now seems to be saying the same thing. What is truth? Sometimes we ask it earnestly and anxiously, and sometimes we ask it cynically and just say, well, I'll make up my own truth. We all have our own truth, don't we? Jesus is the truth. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Spoiler alert. Every piece of armor described here, at one point in scripture, Jesus says, I'm that. Gird your loins with truth. Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Gird yourself, clothe yourself, the most intimate, most private parts of yourself, with Jesus. Bring him in closer than anything else. Put him right against your flesh. Bring him in close. Tie him around yourself. He will heal. He will liberate. The truth will set you free. That's the thing Jesus said. You will know the truth and the truth will set you free. And Jesus is the truth. Now, the second and last piece of armor that we'll discuss today is the body armor of righteousness. Have you ever heard the saying that the best offense is a good defense? This is true in sports and in war, physical war, right? That if you have a good defense, you can take your time and figure out where your opponent's weaknesses are and figure out how to score on offense. But if you've got a good defense, yes, you're golden. And body armor or a breastplate is kind of the image here, is your main piece of defensive gear. It's, you know, all your vital stuff is kind of between, you got the brain. We're going to talk about the helmet in a minute, but most of your vital organs are right up in here, right? You know, you can lose a leg and still be okay. Can't really take a chunk out of the middle of you and be okay. And so the breastplate, the body armor, it defends all those vital organs. And if you're wearing something that protects all that, well, you can take a lot of blows. A lot of arrows can dink right off you and you're going to be okay. And what protects all that is vital? What are we to wear as a breastplate, but righteousness? We are protected. It's for our own good when we walk with Christ and as Christ instructs us to walk. You know, like you tell a lie and then it snowballs and then you get caught and it does you bad. It gets you in trouble. Lose your job, lose a relationship, right? cheat on your taxes. You pick the sin, you pick the thing, whatever it is, if it's sin, it will hurt you. You're like taking the arrow and saying, yep, do that. But when you live righteously, when you walk with Christ, it protects you from all that. You don't got to worry about remembering what you said if you always speak the truth. You don't need to worry about getting caught if you've already done what is right. Now, thank God that when we fall, there is grace. Thank God that when sin has lodged itself in us, our physician, the great physician, can take that out and heal us. But you know what's even better than having him take that arrow out and heal you? Is if you don the breastplate of righteousness and that arrow never sinks into you to begin with. That's better, isn't it? It's better to put on righteousness and to walk with integrity and to never have to deal with it. Now, when we sin, we have an advocate and we have a healer and we have a helper. But Jesus, the great physician, is saying, you know what's an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure, right? Put on that breastplate of righteousness. Walk with integrity. And you won't have to be hurt that way. And that's true right now. We all have sin in our past. And the physician's working on that. But today, right now, going forward, you can say, I'm going to put on that breastplate. I'm going to walk as Jesus wants me to walk. By his help, with his help, I'm going to do that. And you won't have to be wounded again. You really don't have to be. That's such a gift that we're given that the king shares his armor with us. Because this is the armor of God. Not ours. It's his. It's his righteousness that becomes ours. In 1 Corinthians 1:30, and I'm using the NRSV translation, which is a very literal translation. It says, God is why you are in Christ Jesus. God has folded you into the body of Christ. Who? You're in Christ. Who's Christ? Well, he became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Jesus is our righteousness. He is the truth. And we are to gird ourselves up with him. And it is him and his righteousness that we put over our hearts and our vital organs. It is his way we walk. It is his precepts as recorded in Matthew 5, 6, and 7 and throughout the Gospels, as anticipated in the Old Testament, as ruminated on by Paul in the epistles. It is his way that we walk. It is his version of righteousness, not what I say is righteous up here, not what somebody else says is righteous, what Jesus says, what he says we do. And when we walk in his way, we are putting on his righteousness. We're putting on that breastplate of righteousness, and it will protect us from the darts, from the arrows, from the javelins and the spears and the swords that the enemy may try to come at us with. And you won't have to see him as a physician to remove it, because you will have already taken from him his righteousness as protection. Next time we will conclude this passage, we'll look at the four other pieces of armor that are given to us. But for this morning, I want to encourage you to remember that you have an enemy. And you are summoned by God in this passage to be prepared, not to panic or be afraid, but to be prepared. Know that we face a battle, and we ought to face it with intentionality so that we can stand. And the way you can face it is by running to the king whose armor you need. And saying, will you fit it onto me, dear Jesus? Will you help me and my brothers and sisters in this church gird ourselves about with you as the truth and lay you over our hearts as our true righteousness, that we may be protected and insulated from the enemy? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for giving us Jesus as truth and righteousness. We thank you that you have not left us defenseless in the face of an enemy, but instead, Lord God, you are our champion. You are the warrior who defends us. And you put upon us your own son's armor. You deck us out in the king's own gear. May we bring right up against ourselves in our inmost being the love of Jesus and the love of his truth. May we watch the lies that we tell ourselves and repudiate them. May we find courage from you to speak the truth to ourselves, to you, and to others, and therefore find that truth liberating and refreshing and protective. May we also, Lord, don your righteousness, walk in your ways, and find the blessing that comes to all who do. We pray these things in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's stand and conclude with the song, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. He is the armor we wear. He's the fortress we run to. He is the champion who saves us.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amidst the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man side, the man of God's own choosing, the scarecrow that may be, Christ Jesus, it is he, the Lord of hosts, his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. Thank you.
In the battles you face, the temptations that the enemy will throw you, the hardships with which he may try to pummel you, you have a defender. You have a fortress with impenetrable walls and high parapets. You have a king who puts his armor on you and makes you fit for it. Go forth in his armor, girded with truth, covered with righteousness, and protected by Jesus. Amen. God bless you as you go.
Hey, Pat, we're going to shut down. You take it easy, brother. Get your rest. We'll keep you in prayer. We'll talk to you soon.
I'll talk to myself first, not there.